right, Outland.
Bobby mentioned he met you. He's had quite the adventure.
Who's Bobby? Martha?
I missed our Bobby so much. We barely got out of that base with our lives.
You're the kid's parents.
The MC just wrote us off like that.
I thought you were dead.
They were gonna give our son to a different family.
Bobby!
We made it back just in time.
I just ran into them.
Hey, it's you again.
Hey. New step parents? No. It's his own parents. Good to see you, kid.
You too. These are my parents. I told everyone they just got on a different shuttle, but nobody would listen. We're just exploring New Atlantis. We have a new apartment. This place is amazing.
Cool.
Anyway, it was nice to see you again. Maybe I'll see you around. And don't forget my birthday. It's June 11th.
June 11th. Awesome. You better go after him.
He's quite something, our Bobby, isn't he?
Yeah, don't let him get away this time. I really thought they were dead and he was just, you know, a kid and didn't know, or he couldn't begin his mourning process.
I feel underdressed.
Yeah, I don't know why they set up shop here.
Trackers.
They'd be better off in Neon, but Outland's used to people like us.
So the hardware is worth the trip?
Best in the satellite systems. Expensive as hell, but once you are kitted out, we can go after the big bounties.
I just wish everyone wasn't staring at us.
Hmm. Screw them. Let's do some business.
Just passing through.
Hi. Not looking for trouble.
If you need serious firepower, Outland's one of the best.
Well, let's go check it out. I don't need anything right now, but... I am determined to explore everything. Where's your gun displays?
You're only as safe as your equipment out there. Welcome to Outland. We deal in only the finest, most reliable gear for whatever adventures may await you. All of our products come highly recommended by individuals who have devoted their lives to distant travel. And while I've never needed them myself, I stand by everything we offer.
Hmm. Buck naked. All these responses, okay. I'm surprised you don't use any of the things you sell.
I've never left the planet, so no, I do not.
You've never really been to space?
Goodness, no, I just couldn't. You're out there millions of miles away from anything, and if something goes wrong, I can't stomach the thought. I prefer solid ground under my feet at all times. And preferably a hot, fresh coffee within reach. Can't get those in space either.
You get a lot of repeat customers?
I do. In this line of work, it's essential, don't you think? Not seeing people come back would not only suggest that they're not satisfied with our business, but that whatever they purchased had failed, leaving them unable to return. I would not be able to sleep at night if I thought that were the case.
All right, what do you have for sale then?
Yes, by all means, have a look.
Yes, all means. So all you have for weapons is this cutter? I'll take these. I have a lot of med packs still. Yeah, not too great of a selection.
Be careful out there.
Oh, they sent credits somewhere. You guys didn't know.
Not here on business. Just shopping.
You don't know what you're talking about. He doesn't have much. A GalBank. Not books, just notebooks.
I need to find a store with good watercolors. I like the way they bleed on the canvas.
The way she said bleed on the canvas now.
Hey.
Muria. Hey yourself.
Yeah, good talk.
What are you doing here?
Trying to get a job at GalBank.
Oh, yeah?
It's the big building with the word GalBank on it.
I know what it is. Thanks for clearing that up.
You're welcome. Anyway, yeah, I'd like to be a banker. It'll be fun.
Why do you want to work at GalBank?
Because magic isn't real, which means I can't be a necromancer.
That's as
good a reason. I figured being a soul-sucking banker was the next best thing.
That's as good a reason as anything. Can you tell me more about yourself?
Why?
I'm a social butterfly. No, because I just hate myself.
Huh. Guess we have that in common. All right. I like to paint. I like to crochet. Pretty much hate everything else.
Painting and crochet.
You're starting to grow on me, though. Like a fungus. But I like mushrooms. Guess that's the third thing.
Okay. Mushrooms. Painting and... what's the other thing? Crocheting, right? Anything I can do for you?
Yeah. Find a GalBank teller and deposit all your credits into my bank account. Yes. It'll be paid, of course. Eventually. Mm-hmm.
What's all that about? I want to talk to her more, though. She's different than everyone else around here.
GalBank makes personal finance easy. Money, as long as you have some, should never be something to worry about handling.
Okay.
I do hope you're taking advantage of our remote transaction benefits.
Let's try to get her a job. Alright. Well, good luck. It's a lot of wide open space and buildings with not much to do in them. Distributions. That's right, I was heading this way, right? Embassy. Oh, that's right, the Embassy District. I've technically been there, just haven't looked around. But I've discovered it. Where am I now? Varun Embassy Lobby. Wait, only what? An entrance override can unlock. Does this lead to all different embassies? I'm on the roof of something. I don't know what building I'm on top of. Is this the GalBank still? Infinity Limited HQ. Only maintenance access keycard can unlock. Huh. You know these like rooftop entrances to these places. Like, if I found an abandoned place like this, I'd be walking on it. I'd be doing this in real life, but probably not getting as close to the edge as I currently am. I can't jump that. Oh. That was like a semi-jump scare. Like a jump startle. A huge robot suddenly appearing in front of you. I guess I was on top of the GalBank building.
Apply today at the nearest kiosk.
Oh hey, what's up?
Wasabi. That's the same person. This building. Sanctum Universum Church, huh? Oops.
There are so many mysteries in the universe, so many unknowns that I try to help out others whenever I get the chance. I may not always have the perfect advice for people, but I try to just be here for them. I think that's what they really need more than anything else. Were you seeking worldly wisdom or just a friendly ear?
Both. I'm seeking friendly, worldly wisdom. The meaning of life would be good, for a start.
It would, wouldn't it?
42?
Well, if you find it, be sure to come back and let me know.
42.
It would make the next sermon more memorable, if nothing else. And in the meantime, while it isn't quite so profound, I might suggest reading some of our works. Among the Grab Jumps is a good place to start. I'm sure you can find a copy lying about. And if you do decide to read it, perhaps you'd let me know what you think. See if it speaks to you, as it has to others.
Okay. Yeah, as long as I can actually take it and it's not a steal and I get, you know, apprehended by police. Yeah, I don't think I've had the pleasure.
That's all right. I'm sure it just escaped your memory. So many things do over time.
No, I haven't read it.
There must be a copy around here somewhere. If you do happen to peruse it, I would enjoy hearing your thoughts on the idea.
Yeah, give it a look.
Wonderful. I really would be happy to discuss it with you sometime.
Hmm. He really wants to talk about this book.
Is there anything I can help with?
Can you tell me about the Sanctum Universum?
Well, we're a newer organization, at least officially. Our facility here in New Atlantis has only been around a few decades. But we're gaining new members all the time. I think people have been grasping for something to express what they're experiencing, and I'm glad we can be here for them.
Hmm. You're a priest?
Keeper by title. But yes, I suppose the title fits. I'm very grateful that I have the opportunity to be here for those who need us, who find meaning in our message.
Yeah, I'm not gonna tell him that.
The Sanctum will always be here for those who seek it.
A wooden puzzle box. I can read these. I can take them. Alright, so if you guys don't want to hear me reading, don't watch this part. Sanctum Universum 1, 2, and 3. Greater End 1 and 3. Where's 2? Where's Greater End Volume 2? I can't. I'll skip that volume. I'll read these three. Sanctum Universum, and I'll read Among the Grav Jumps, and I'll talk to him again because he really wants to talk about this with me. Sanctum Universum, Volume 1. A Spiritual Guide for After the World's End by Keeper Aquilus of the Sanctum Universum, Volume 1. All people by nature desire to know. This is the maxim of the philosopher, the start of our most ancient discourse, and the continuing truth that unites humanity's current diaspora to its cradle around the yellow sun. The death of Earth may be cause for wistful reflection. It's time as the center of humanity recedes ever further into the past, and living generations find it so removed from their existence as to amount to nothing more than historical trivia. Our technology and culture advance to forms that would be scarcely recognizable as human to even our recent forebears, and yet we still identify as part of the same lineage that first tamed fires and noticed that certain of the lesser heavenly lights seem to move in patterns. This taming and noticing, the vital combination of act and reflection, is what separates us from all other beings we have yet encountered. This is the foregone existence of humankind. All people desire to know. We have to see. We have to know. The subjects of that knowledge may vary across different cultures, epochs, and individual proclivities, but the need to know, to draw existing knowledge into new combinations, and to expand what exists is ever present. Even the simplest of us seeks to know their neighbor, or themselves, or their work. The more ambitious intellects may seek to know the truth of galactic superstructures or the social origins of modernity. That pursuit unites us as a single race more than any biological coincidence or historical lineage can. Not all knowledges of the intellect, however, and different principled approaches may yield their subsequently different conclusions or qualities of understanding altogether. Here is where the first serious objections may be raised, particularly as the disciples of scientism begin the inhale of their great collective bellows so as to put forth pure empiricism as the only valid means of knowledge. I do not wish to dampen their enthusiasm, nor do I deny the great benefits that have been found through that approach. Some of our earliest recorded disputes in the history of thought stem from whether reason or experience is the right path to knowledge. Our senses may be easily deceived, so we are forced to confront the possibility that they are always so. Our minds can be addled by decrepitude or confused by ideologies, making them no more trustworthy. To assign a place of privilege to either reason or experience is itself a curatorial act which exists as part of a long philosophical tradition, whether the chooser knows so or not. All of this is to bring me around to my greater point, that of faith. I speak not here of supernatural belief itself, though I will shortly come to it. Rather, faith is the acceptance of a truth that has been given from another. Whether the other came to it by reason or experience, whether the other is one superior or inferior, whether the truth is a factual or qualitative one does not matter. By incorporating a truth into one's knowledge without having arrived at it by individual means, a person is committing an act of faith. Faith takes many forms that may be unexpected. The most passionate science chauvinist may never heard that one may observe, may believe in the existence of atoms even though such things have not been, cannot be observed directly. They believe in them out of a trust in sound evidence and mathematical proofs. But even then, have they themselves seen the evidence? Have they themselves performed the mathematics? At some point in their epistemological journey toward greater knowing, they have, with near certainty, accepted some truth on faith. That faith may be in their teachers, in their texts, in the process of peer review, in the very existence of causality. But faith remains. Which brings me then to the question of supernatural belief, particularly the ways such beliefs manifested in human religions over the course of our history. In these matters, both believers and unbelievers are quite willing to say that the method of knowing is faith. That reason may also be applied to these same matters is unsurprising, particularly in light of the original maxim which opened this text. Many a towering intellect has turned the full force of its powers to questions of faith, and these inquiries may prove to be enlightening exercises regardless of the reader's own commitments. There is, though, a point of departure, for at the core, the very foundation of their thought, there is an assumption of the existence of something that these thinkers choose to label as God. Well, I hope the other volumes are more interesting to read. Sanctum Universum, Volume 2, A Spiritual Guide for After the World's End, by Keeper Aquilus of the Sanctum Universum, Volume 2. The concept that such philosophers label as God is not necessarily that of any particular faith tradition. There is a noble attempt, with varied levels of success, to separate the doctrinal tenets of their lived religion from the philosophical projects they undertook. Their philosophical reasoning differs from that of a non-believer merely in that they were willing to allow for the possibility of existence of something labeled as God. However, none of them set out to prove such an existence, since that question is itself the exemplar of non-falsifiability. The question of the existence of something that might be considered God is outside the realm of reason. However, once a person has come to accept either belief or non-belief as a truth via some act of faith, then reason can subsequently be employed to continue a discourse with that axiom. So what do we mean, then, when we are to speak of something labeled God? You may note that I have not yet called this something directly and have never used the more traditional label without the deployment of quotation marks. This is to intentionally set distance between whatever associations a reader may have with the concept, all the bundles of traditions and dogmas and doctrines and persecutions and violence and mania can all be set aside for the moment. I need you to forget everything you think you know about something that people might label as God. Clear your mind to the tabula rasa as best you are able and we proceed from here. Now, from this blankness, esteemed philosophers have derived notions of the self or time and space as the singular foundation for understanding reality. I do not need to recapitulate their ideas here. I trust a well-equipped data terminal may bestow upon you the gifts of the meditator and the imperator in this matter. Whatever sort of epistemological framework you choose to adopt, let us assume that you have agreed to some notion of the self and some notion of reality, even if you don't agree that the one can actually perceive the other. And here the truest existential nihilists who wish to deny even reality itself may exit the car. Recall our prime maxim that all people by nature desire to know. And so from this blankness we ask questions. Who are my parents? What is justice? Why do stars twinkle? Should I pursue a romantic relationship? All of these inquiries are ways of knowing and ways of thinking and ways of acting, and underlying all of it is the reality that we share. For ultimately, all questions eventually become some sort of why. Why did my parents abandon me? Why was this injustice committed? Why was I rejected? And whys have a ways of coalescing toward a unified point. Your parents abandoned you because of their addictions, which came from their hardships, which came from their unjust society, which was formed out of scarcity, which is a consequence of mineral distribution on the planet, which derives from the relative weights of various elements in a molten protoplanet, which is correlated with their atomic mass, which relates to the interaction of subatomic particles, which, and so proceed ad infinitum. But not quite, because ultimately there is an epistemic barrier beyond which We can no longer ask why. Why do subatomic particles act the way they do? Because of quantum strings. Why do they act the way they do? Because of the laws of mathematics and physics. Why are those laws what they are? Why does causality exist? Why does anything exist at all? That the chain of questions continues toward this asymptote cannot be denied. The staunchest unbeliever may be quite wary that the line of questioning is approaching realms that science can no longer address, but still they cannot deny the question itself. They may only assert that they do not care about the answer. These questions exist to their conclusion, though, whether or not we choose to concede defeat earlier in the sequence. Well, that was a little interesting. A little more interesting. And now, Volume 3. Volume 3. So we face the question of why there is even a reality to contemplate and find the tools of our minds lacking. There is unquestionably a mystery underlying all reality, and I do not speak of mystery in the sense of a puzzle we cannot solve or a murder that cannot be attributed. Rather, I speak of mystery, the proper noun, something so remote that it is not simply unknown but unknowable. Such mysteries can also appear in a more mundane context, such as the attempts to answer the question of who are you, without giving the more simple answers of your name, your occupation, your ethnicity, etc. Yeah, when Sheridan and Delenn were basically interrogated and tortured by who we know used to be Jack the Ripper. Who are you? Such mysteries can also... the mystery I speak of that underlies all reality is unknowable to the same extent that you and I are unknowable, not because it is so distant, although it is, but because it is also so close. Transcendence and immanence come to a paradoxical unity in a concept that our minds can barely comprehend the proper shape of its question. So then, the mystery that underlies all reality is the very same thing that many in our past and present choose to label as God. I myself will not use such a label out of both respect and caution about its traditional usage, but let us acknowledge that we are speaking of the same thing. What function does this concept have in a hostile universe? This is why I ask you to discard all your previous notions tied to the mystery, because there tends to be an assumption of benevolence or care associated therein. Already, that is skipping many steps as it ascribes a selfhood to the mystery, which is a prerequisite for an intent, which is a prerequisite for will, which is needed before any ideas of agency can be questioned. A great deal of intellectual work remains to prove those concepts, and we will arrive to them in time. But for now, avoid thinking of the mystery as anything other than the unknowable thing which underlies reality. The ground of being, the very cause of existence itself. That is more interesting and far more fruitful a starting place than any Sky King creators of ages past. This form of mystery becomes our frontier, our new frontier of knowing. The acts and reflections that unite us to our ancestors continue in our new milieu, but are forced by circumstance to reconsider all truths from the very first principles. For those who wish to embark on the crucial philosophical voyage of this chapter of humanity, I open my mind and provide these writings as guides and signposts. Seek me out or seek my words, it makes no difference to those who wish to know the truth. For indeed, all people by nature desire to know. Yeah, it's really a great mystery. I mean, what I often wonder about is what causes life to begin. I mean, we know it has to do with amino acids and then such combining and then forming into single-celled creatures and then those evolve, but there's a force in the universe which governs evolution and the beginning of life. So it's kind of hard to reconcile that without thinking that there is some sort of creator out there who've created these beings. Because yes, the building blocks are out there, but what's the imperative that causes these things to start to become life? Right? I mean, I can rationalize it out, say, okay, on such and such a planet, let's just say there's life, there's water, there's amino acids, there's a good temperature. But what causes the spark that starts it all going? Right? Is it something that would inevitably happen if all these factors are there? Or does it sometimes not happen? Sometimes you have water, amino acids, good temperature, sunlight, and everything, but for whatever reason, life does not begin. I don't know. Something I think about. Okay, this is the one he wanted us to look at. Ooh, an encased alien travel bay. Among the grav jumps. Okay. Among the grav jumps, God seeks you. Is God real? The more proper question would be, is reality divine? Existence itself is a mystery which yearns to be uncovered. What is goodness but a comparison to the good? What is existence but a participation in being? Any common attribute invites comparison to some more pure form of it. And as we work our way up the tree of attributes, from apples to red to color to waveforms to energy to space-time to existence, we find fewer and fewer branches to explore. All of reality eventually converges into a single point. Some call it Omega, others Telos. Some call it God, but its true nature is best understood in another way. I think about the Big Bang when you talk about everything in reality converging into a single point. Or converged. For where the diversity of the universe inspires awe and wonder, it exists only in contrast to a simplicity so pure that it may only be understood as primordial and even divine. To say that it exists is effectively redundant, as it is, in fact, existence itself. Our being derives from being. Our essence is what was imagined by its mind. But what we consider imagining and what we consider mind are in fact so far beyond our understanding that even these metaphors are like tiny white caps on a massive surging sea. Okay. Reality is mind, or existence is mind, quote unquote. More urgently, this being which gives rise to reality itself seeks to understand its consequence, by which I mean you and me. Our senses are limited and only able to perceive three dimensions as we are helplessly flung along the fourth in a single direction, right, time. But our finest minds tell us that the universe has at least 12 dimensions, and who knows what further knowledge may be revealed in time. From our meager capacity, the universe is not simply unexplored, but fully unknowable in any comprehensive sense. Right. Yeah, I agree with that. So if we were able to experience all dimensions, then we'd know. We'd know how life is created and all this stuff. How the universe was created, right? And so we rely on revelation. We submit ourselves to direct communication with the one source of truth, for truth is another of its attributes, and even as all the separate aspects resolve into simplicity. To know the truth, we must know the truth. And that truth wishes to know us as well. Our physical embodiments are limited to movement in three dimensions, just as fabric is bound to and defined by its warp and weft. But we have a power that raises us above the unminded matter that merely exists without will. We can bend the fabric of space-time, rending warp from weft, peering through the veil that we may otherwise mistake for all that there is. When we do so, by jumping from point to point, we are not merely moving in space, but becoming voyagers into a new level of understanding. Those moments between grav jumps are not simply nothingness, but glimpses into understanding of the mystery that underlies all reality. To know that truth is to become closer to divine ourselves. This is the purpose of our lives. The purpose of the Sanctum Universum is to guide you in these experiences, so each opportunity to know is not squandered. Seek out Aquilus. Let him open your mind to the understanding that is no different from your mind. And join us as we seek further communion and increase our sharing in the nature of the divine. Oh, it's an actual quest we have to do? It's just an activity. So I read it.
Oh, I hope you have the chance to read more about our beliefs.
Just need that missing volume.
Is there anything I can help with?
I read your writing.
Oh, wonderful. Tell me, what did you think?
None of these, really. I didn't find it very engaging. Found it interesting. Couldn't say I didn't care for it, and the ideas, for the most part, did make sense to me. But I guess I'll just say I found it very engaging.
I'm so glad to hear that. I confess I do feel something of a swell of pride every time I learn my thoughts mean something to others. It's a good reminder that we're onto something here. You're always welcome here if you ever need comfort or advice or just want someone to talk to.
Gee, I thought you would talk more about it. Okay.
May God go with you.
I thought we were going to engage in philosophical discussion. I am disappointed.
I'd heard of the Sanctum growing up, but never thought much of it. Then one day, it happened for me. One simple jump. The same as I'd made dozens of times before, and something touched me. Something warm and kind and good.
TMI.